we continue this series, Loyalty, picking up the story of Naomi and Ruth and Boaz. These are the saints that have gone before us and shown such loyalty. Now, in biblical times, there was no life insurance. And so, you know, there was nothing to help if the provider of the family died. There was nothing to help. And that's the situation that we have, you know, in this patriarchal culture. A widow really was in a difficult position. If there wasn't someone else to provide for her. And that's kind of where we go in the story today. That's what's happening. This Hebrew word that I shared last time, chesed, that is the Hebrew word for steadfast love and faithfulness and loyalty. Chesed is the kind of love that we receive from God. It's also the kind of love that we can show to one another. And that's the story we hear today. Hear these words. Naomi, her mother-in-law, said to her, "My daughter, I need to seek some security for you so that it may be well with you. Now here is our kinsman Boaz, with whose young women you have been working. See, he is winnowing barley tonight at the threshing floor. Now wash and anoint yourself and put on your best clothes and go down to the threshing floor. But do not make yourself known to the man until he has finished eating and drinking. When he lies down, observe the place where he lies. Then go and uncover his feet and lie down, and he will tell you what to do." She said to her, "All that you tell me, I will do." So Boaz took Ruth, and she became his wife. When they came together, the Lord made her conceive, and she bore a son. Then the women said to Naomi, "Blessed be the Lord who has not left you this day without next of kin. May his name be renowned in Israel. He shall be to you a restorer of life and a nourisher of your old age, for your daughter-in-law who loves you, who is more to you than seven sons, has borne him." Then Naomi took the child and laid him in her bosom and became his nurse. The women of the neighborhood gave him a name, saying, "A son has been born to Naomi." They named him Obed. He became the father of Jesse, the father of David. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. All right, so last week we heard, once upon a time, there was a famine in the land of Bethlehem, the house of bread. And so this particular man, Elimelech, and his wife Naomi, their two sons, Mahlon and Chilion, they left home and they moved to the country of Moab. That's enemy territory, you know. They went to Moab, where bad things happen. Death followed. First, you know, there's this famine of bread. Now there's a famine of life. So Elimelech died, and then the two sons took Moabite wives, Orpah and Ruth. They lived for 10 years. But then the two sons, Mahlon and Chilion, they died as well. Now, Naomi heard that God was providing bread, food, once again in the house of bread, and returned home. Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, Naomi, and said goodbye, but Ruth clung to her, showing her great loyalty, pledged to go with her and to live with her and to even be buried where Naomi was buried. She said, "Don't make me leave. Where you go, I go. Your people shall be my people, your God, my God." And so back in Bethlehem, Ruth went out to the harvest field and joined the gleaners. The Torah, the law for the Hebrew people, the Israelites, the Torah obliged Israelite farmers to allow strangers, even it seems enemy strangers, Moabites, to allow strangers and orphans and widows to glean food from their field. You know, just little bit by little bit, get a little bit. They were even supposed to leave some of the harvest for them. And the landowner, Boaz, he took notice of Ruth, and so he protected her. He gave her water and some food, told her where she should do her work. And Ruth said, "Why are you doing this for me?" And Boaz said, "Well, I've inquired about you, and I heard about you. I've heard about this great loyalty that you have shown your mother-in-law, Naomi. And so may the Lord reward you for the decisions you've made, for the actions that you've taken." And we get this sort of glimpse of redemption for whoever seeks shelter with our God, with the God of Israel. Now, it seems that Boaz was attracted to Ruth, I mean, at least in part because of her character, that is the way she treated her mother-in-law, Naomi, but also, you know, he had seen how hard she worked in the field. when Ruth told Naomi about Boaz, she was so very excited because Boaz was a relative of her late husband, Elimelech. He was one of their nearest kin, and so he was what was called a redeeming kinsman. And so Naomi wanted Ruth to continue going out with the women to that field so she could glean there with the women of Boaz until the end of the harvest. That way they'd be sure to get some provision for them. All right, still, Naomi was left without a husband. She had no sons. This was a patriarchal culture. And it's not too much to say a woman really needed some man, a father, a brother, a son, a close relative, someone that would protect and provide in a patriarchal culture. And so the question in this whole story is, how are Naomi and Ruth going to survive? I mean, in the ancient Near East, this is thousands of years ago, there was no life insurance if someone like that died, nothing to help if a provider died. A widow in a patriarchal culture really was left in a very difficult position. And that's why there's so much in the law about caring for the poor and for the orphans and for the widows. After the famine and the death that had happened both in Bethlehem and in Moab, the question is, would now there be new life in the house of bread in Bethlehem? So Naomi said to Ruth, "My daughter, I need to seek some security for you. Maybe it's time now to make our move. So tonight is the night of Boaz's barley harvest at the threshing floor. And this is what I want you to do." She's talking to Ruth. "I want you to take a bath, right? Get all cleaned up and put on some perfume. Get all dressed up and take yourself down to the threshing floor. But don't let him know that you're there. Not yet. Not until after he has finished eating and drinking. And then when he goes to lie down and go to sleep, then go uncover his feet and lie down. And he'll tell you what to do." And Ruth said, "I'll do everything you say." So Ruth went down to the threshing floor. She did what Naomi had instructed. Boaz was eating, was drinking, and when he was content, he went to lay down at the end of a heap of grain, and Ruth slipped in quietly and lay down at his feet. And at midnight, Boaz was startled. I mean, there was a woman at his feet, and he said, "Who are you, and what are you doing here?" And she said, "I'm Ruth. Let me under the covers, for you are a kinsman redeemer." Now, I don't mean to embarrass anyone. And in fact, one of my older commentaries from pretty close to 70 years ago, it suggested, you know, maybe it's just best to just leave this alone, not even talk about it. But the reality is we live in a bit of a different time today. And frankly, I tend to not leave stuff alone. So there's some innuendo going on in this story. Now, lying down, it could mean simply going to sleep, but it also very much could imply sex. And uncovering his feet, well, that could mean uncovering, well, you know. And the idea that Boaz would tell her what to do, I mean, again, sort of bawdy and suggestive. And going to the threshing floor, that was already associated with sex for hire. Now, we don't know what took place, and it may have been completely innocent. The reality is, however, even if nothing more happened than the conversation, Ruth going to the threshing floor and sleeping next to a man that was not her husband, that in itself would have been pretty scandalous. It's sort of like this. So a guy is working and he meets a nice young woman. He goes to bed that night, but he wakes up and he discovers she's in his bed. And she looks at him sort of coyly and says, "I want you to marry me." See, now when this happened to Boaz, Boaz was like, "All right, may the Lord bless you. Bless you. Because this act of loyalty is even better than your first," that is, that act of loyalty which Ruth had shown for Naomi. And he said to her, look, you could have had your pick of any of the young men around here. But she chose him. And so he told her to not be afraid. He wanted to redeem her. He did. But there was a problem. The reality was there was another redeeming kinsman who was actually a closer kinsman. And so Boaz said he'd see in the morning if that next of kin would redeem her. Otherwise, as surely as the Lord lives, for sure, he would definitely be the one to redeem her. She lay at his feet until dawn, but then she got up while it was still dark so that she wouldn't be recognized. Boaz was concerned about anyone recognizing her and knowing that she had gone to the threshing floor. I mean, you remember what the threshing floor was sort of associated with. So he gave her some food to take for her and for Naomi, and then he sent her on her way. Right away, early in the morning, Boaz went to the city gate to accomplish what he said he would do, what he had promised Ruth the night before. He had to deal with this redeeming relative who was actually a little bit closer than him to the family of Elimelech. And Boaz ran into this next of kin, and then he convened a civil court. And what that means is they went out to this to the city gate, and they got together 10 elders. They didn't have courthouses for judgments and legal action, that kind of stuff. They did official business at the city gate with a certain number of elders, a certain number of those respected and wise persons who served then as formal witnesses. Boaz told them Naomi was back and she was selling the land that belonged to Elimelech. And so he told the next of kin that he should redeem it. But if he wouldn't, then Boaz would redeem it. Now, I mentioned this last time, but this idea of redemption, it refers to the process by which people, property, prestige are restored to a family that has lost them, whether that's through poverty or violence or some other cause. Now, the redeemer is the designated family member who is expected to accomplish this, who is expected to recover that which has been removed from the family control. In other words, redemption is all about returning you to yourself, returning you to who you are meant to be. In the civil court at the city gate, there were really two legal issues going on here. There was the redemption of the land and the perpetuation of the name of the man who had died. Redeeming the land was important. It respected and protected that allocation of land according to family. So if a parcel of land had to be sold, a near relative, a kinsman, was to buy it to keep it in the family. So again, here Boaz, he invited this near kinsman to purchase the parcel of land that had belonged to Elimelech. Now, there's a tension in the story here because we know that Boaz and Ruth have come together and they want to be together. But now this kinsman that's a little bit closer than Boaz says, yes, I will acquire the land. But you see, if he acquires the land, then that's going to get in the way of Boaz and Ruth. So Boaz then brought up this other issue, this other legal concern. He said, all right, so the day that you acquire the field from the hand of Naomi, you are also acquiring Ruth the Moabite, the widow of the deceased, to maintain the dead man's name on his inheritance. And this story is sort of shedding some light on some cultural aspects that we don't practice today. So Boaz is pointing out the so-called levirate marriage, where the brother of a deceased man was obliged to marry his brother's widow and even produce children for that man. And it was usually a brother in this practice of levirate marriage, but here Boaz was calling for it just with the nearest kinsman. And we don't know why, But the unnamed next of kin declined. He said he couldn't do it. Yeah, he'd buy the field, or he'd buy the land, but he didn't want to get married. So he sort of took himself out of that and stepped back. And there was an interesting custom at the time to confirm a transaction. One person would take off a sandal and give it to the other person so that when the next of kin said that Boaz should be the one, he should be the redeeming kinsman, he took off his sandal, he gave it to Boaz, and Boaz then said to the elders gathered at the city gate, "Today you are the witnesses that I have acquired from Naomi all that belonged to Elimelech, Mahlon, and Chilion, and that I have also acquired Ruth to be my wife, to maintain Mahlon's name on his inheritance." And the elders at the city gate said, "Yes, we are witnesses." Now, there was no written contract, right? But the oral agreement that was witnessed was binding. And that's what happened. The elders, they pronounced their blessing on this new family. So Boaz took Ruth as his wife. And when they came together by the grace of God, she conceived and bore a son. And then the women said to Naomi, "Blessed be the Lord," because the welfare of Naomi and Ruth was secure. I mean, there was a future for this family that didn't have a future, a family that had seemed doomed. And this child was surrounded by mother and grandmother, and the women of the town who blessed Naomi also said, "May this child be famous throughout Israel. He shall be a restorer of life, a redeemer, for your daughter-in-law Ruth is even better than seven sons," which is this sort of amazing thing to say in this patriarchal culture. This one woman is even better than multiple sons. And the women named the child Obed, which means worshiper or servant of God. And here's the thing, all right? You ready? Here's the thing. This child, Obed, became the father of Jesse, who was the father of David, King David, the greatest king of Israel, someone truly after God's own heart. And not only that, then, King David was the seed of the Messiah, Jesus, the one closest to God's heart who redeems all people. So this final scene, these closing words show a deeper meaning when it moves from the birth of the child Obed, who represents sort of this redemption for Naomi, to the birth of David, whose line promises redemption for the whole people of God, and indeed all people, through Jesus, the Messiah. This little story tells us that through Ruth, a foreigner, poor, childless, a Moabite enemy, through Ruth, God is at work in surprising and unexpected ways. These are ordinary people, but these ordinary people, they go beyond what is expected, what the law required. These people who do that, who act loyally and compassionately, they're the ancestors of kings. And that speaks to us, I think. I mean, God often works through the most unlikely people, and we're pretty unlikely people. But we too can act with this loyalty, with this steadfast love, with this chesed. But that's not all. There's more. Right? So Ruth was a foreigner. She was this Moabite. And this story seems to be a protest against the very narrow nationalism of a couple of other Old Testament books, Ezra and Nehemiah. And in those books, the Jewish men were required to divorce their Gentile wives, that is, their wives who weren't Jewish, for the sake of this racial purity. And I think that speaks to our inclusiveness today. I mean, the line of King David that leads to the line of Jesus, the Messiah, these, these lineages were not pure. They were mixed, even including what we might call kind of scandalous characters. And so we too, we are called to include outsiders, strangers, characters, because what counts is character, not the color of skin or ethnicity or the language that's spoken or any of that. What counts is that God loves all people, the beautiful diversity of all of us, human beings, not just the ones who look like us or talk like us or think like us. God works in many different peoples. But there's more. The story shows us not just that we, you know, ought to be like Ruth, showing such loyalty and steadfast love, such chesed. She's a wonderful, wonderful example for us. It's not just that we ought to be like Ruth, but this story shows us, I think, that we are like Naomi. Naomi experiences the brokenness and the blessing of life, the bitterness and the joy. Naomi is the one who needs this redemption, and she gets it, but it's not given as a reward for her behavior. That's kind of how it is for Ruth, but that's not how it is for Naomi. No, she gets this redemption because of the faithfulness of someone else. And that's how it is for us. See, like Naomi, we too, we experience the brokenness and the blessing of life, the bitterness and the joy, and we need redemption. We need to be regenerated. We need to be made new. We need to be returned to who we are meant to be. We need to be restored. And we get that. Even though we don't deserve it, we get that. And not because of our behavior. It's not some sort of reward for the way we behave. We get it because of someone else's loyalty and steadfast love, someone else's chesed. We get it because of Jesus. Remember, redemption is this regeneration. It's restoration. Redemption returns you to yourself, to who you are meant to be. And that is good news. And for that, we can say thanks be to God. This regeneration, this restoration, this redemption is offered to you and me by God's action in Jesus Christ. Have you been redeemed? Do you want to be redeemed? If you want God's offer of redemption, of restoration, of making you new again, of returning you to who you are meant to be, I invite you to share that with God, even right now. Let us pray. Lord God, we give you thanks for sharing yourself with us in Jesus, for being that designated family member to redeem us, to restore us, to regenerate us and the entire world, to return us to who we are meant to be, to who you intend for us to be. And so, Lord, some right now are saying thank you for that offer of redemption and receiving that. Lord, we give you thanks for Jesus, for all that you have done in Jesus, for that is the good news, that is the gospel, all that you have done in Jesus. Give you thanks.